like I've been gone for like a month and I only missed one Sunday.
Three.
It's like, you know what's funny is when I go away for one Sunday and these other people miss for like a month, they're like, where are you at today? I forgot you went to my church still. What are you talking about? I showed up today.
Turn him down.
We love him anyway. So I'm going to get right into this real quick. You know, the last time I was here, we preached on James, and we talked. How good? Don't miss all my stuff. Oh, okay. If we sit back up there, just all the way to the front, some of these things James is going to have on the deal.
Yeah.
Maybe just turn right up against the plate here. Can you see that better? Can you guys see it on this side? Oh my goodness, Lord.
Funny, that's the exact same
thing. Hey, take a picture. Maybe sit down. We'll try that. All things are possible, isn't it?
Negative.
I think we're cruising for a bruising here.
Negative.
They don't have to read the bottom eight because we're going to put them on the board.
Yeah.
Can you see? We have special seating for the blind people. All things are going to go wrong today, I can tell already. Can you see that better?
Yeah.
Oh. My wife's going to hit it on the you, Scott. That's why Scott's a leader here. He's a problem solver. We'll have to work something around that there. I'll stand over here. Is that okay? I kind of like this side better anyway. It's the right side, right? No, that's why I moved over here. Last time I was here, we talked about James, right? We started in James 1, and James says that if you ask in faith and do not doubt, and what we talked about was the word doubt was rooted in unbelief in shame, condemnation, and guilt. And so what it says is if you have doubt, don't expect to receive from the Lord. It didn't say that you wouldn't get from the Lord, right? I think most of our Christian walk, our faith walk and stuff has been getting things from God. If I can work up enough faith, if I can pray hard enough, God will move in my situation. But I got news for you guys. God is seated. He's not moving anymore. Uh-oh. There's nothing left to give you. He's given you everything. He's given you His kingdom. So what do I do now? I have to receive that, right? Here's what I mean by that before I go into my message. What I mean is we feel like at times that if I have enough faith, if I quote one scripture just enough times, that 151st time, it's going to break open heaven and God's going to do something. Right? How many of us done that before? By His stripes, I am healed. By His stripes, I am healed. By His stripes. If I say this enough today, God's going to heal me. Amen? But the reality of it is by His stripes, you are healed. Right? It's not about I'm not saying there's anything wrong with confessing Scripture. But you got to convince yourself, right? You're not trying to convince God. He's fully convinced that what Jesus did on the cross was enough. Amen? Like you asking for forgiveness is not convincing God that you need to be forgiven. He knew you needed to be forgiven, but He forgave you already. And it's convincing you, yourself, that I am forgiven. Amen?
Amen.
So, in the Bible, it starts out like, so let me say this. When I got done, after I left here that last Sunday, I went home and I was up till midnight. I was laying in bed and all these things about the heart was coming up. And I had to get out of bed and I went and looked up. I got a little e-sword that tells me everywhere in the Bible that the word heart is used. I believe it's over 800 times. And so I'm going through at 10 o'clock at night, 11 o'clock at night, go, whoa, this is good stuff, this is good stuff, this is good stuff. and I couldn't sleep. And I tell you what, when I was in Virginia last week, I was up in the morning going through this stuff. I was up at night going through this stuff. So here's we're probably going to be on the heart for a little bit, okay? Because we're teaching on authority, right? This is really the series we're in is a series on authority. But the reality of it is, until we change some things in our heart, we're never going to walk in authority. We're always going to walk with doubt, right? We're never going to receive the fullness of what God has for us. And so I might be a little redundant in the next few weeks talking about the heart, because here's one of the bad things about being a bivocational pastor is that if I was a full-time pastor, I'd probably sit down and really put the whole series together and go chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3. So here's what's probably going to happen, though. I'm going to jump into this thing, and you might get chapter 3, and then next week you might get chapter 1. And then the week after that you might get chapter 9, and we might come back to chapter 2. Okay? But here's what I'm going to do. I am not going to leave any stone unturned until I fully understand this, because I honestly believe this is what keeps the church from walking in the fullness that God has for us. I honestly believe it's a heart issue. It's not about your mind. It's not about getting God to do something. It's not about you being a good boy or a bad boy or a good girl or a bad girl. That's what the church always told us, you know. Like, if God's not healing you, it's because you're bad or you don't have faith or you got sin in your life. But the reality of it is, He healed you before you ever asked for forgiveness. He healed you 2,000 years ago. You were healed. Right? You were in Christ before the foundation of the world. So, and throw this out there, the work that He began in you, He'll complete until the day of redemption. Amen. That's not making you more holy. Okay? You got Jesus' holiness right now. Jesus is righteous. The work He began in you is that you believed. And the work He's going to continue in you is that you keep believing. And you believe the whole thing. Right? So you get the whole enchilada. So that's what you want. So, one of our most favorite scriptures that we probably know, John 3:16, for God who so loved the world sent His only begotten Son, that whoever should believe on Him will have, some say everlasting, some say eternal life, right? And so one time Scott taught it here on everlasting or eternal, and it means no beginning and no end, right? And the word life is zoe in the Greek, and it actually is talking about God's kind of life. And so what it's saying is, when you believe in Jesus, you're going to have God's kind of life. It doesn't have a beginning, it doesn't have an end. God's life doesn't have a beginning or have an end. We're supposed to be walking in abundance, in life, and life more abundantly, but many times we're missing the mark. Yeah. Right? Many times we're not receiving the fullness of God. Paul actually writes about this in Ephesians 4:17. He says, "This I say, therefore testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk." He's not talking about, hey, you got my scripture up, kid?
Yeah.
He says, therefore, testify. Okay, he went with the Amplify. We'll go with that. You guys okay with that?
Well, Amplify. Changes
a lot of more words. He says that we should walk not as the Gentiles walk. He's not talking about walking in sin. Okay? I'll tell you, I'll prove it to you. In the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God. How does a Gentile walk? They walk alienated from the life of God. Right? He's telling believers, he's saying, you can be careful that you don't walk alienated from the life of God. Don't walk like the Gentiles do. They don't have the promise. You have the promise. Walk in the promise. The word there, alienated, says non-participants. Don't walk your Christian life out not participating in the life of God that has no beginning and no end. Right. And it says, because of the blindness, I don't know where I stopped off, alienated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of our heart. And that word is hardness. And that every time you see Jesus, they don't, like, every time Jesus is popping out a miracle and they say they don't understand it, Jesus says, because of the hardness of your heart. Colossians 1:27 says this, "To them that God willed to make known that what are the riches of the glory of this mystery to the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory." Let's slow that down. The mystery from the beginning of time has been revealed, and it's Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Colossians 1:27.
The word hope there means joyful expectation. And the word glory there means God's opinion, God's view, and God's reality. So I'm going to give this to you in the BHT translation. Christ in you gives you an expectation, a joyful expectation of God's view, God's opinion, and God's reality. Because Christ is in you, you should be expecting to live in God's reality. And what's God's reality? It's finished. It's blessed. It's healed. It's done. It's complete. You're holy. You're righteous. You have peace. You have joy everywhere you go. Is everybody living in that reality?
No.
Nope. Scott's a little bit. You want to live in that reality?
Yes.
Do we want to? Is the Word of God true?
Yes.
Do we believe the promises of God are for us right now?
Yes.
First thing you're going to have to do is get rid of any shame and condemnation in your heart. You're going to have to persuade your heart to believe that Jesus, because of what Jesus did, you no longer have to have shame anymore. You no longer have to feel that you're going to be punished. You no longer feel like God's holding things back from you because of things that you've done in the past. And no longer feel, because I did this, this is the consequences for that, and God can't move in that. God is going to move in all of it, okay? He's going to make you whole, no matter if you did it, if Juan did it, if Laura did it, He's going to make you whole. Why? Because He loves you, and He's your daddy, right? So we're going to get there. We are, as a church, going to get to the fullness of God manifesting in our life. I'm going to beat it in you until you guys are making $1 million each so I can stop being a bivocational pastor and be a full-time pastor. Amen?
Amen.
And that way I don't have to get the messages, "Pastor, pray for me, I'm sick." No, you're not, you're healed. Nobody can ask me anymore. I got this thing figured out. I got it rigged. I get everybody healed. Everybody's blessed. And I just get to sit back and enjoy the fruit of my labor, right? So let's go. Proverbs 15:15. This is the Amplified. It says, "All the days of the afflicted are bad, but a glad heart has a continual feast, regardless of the circumstances." How many of us want to continually feast? I looked up the word afflicted, and it says depressed in mind or circumstances. The root word here is to browbeat oneself, to look down on oneself. The days of those who browbeat themselves, the days of those who look down on themselves are always bad. But those who have a merry heart will have a continual feast. I also looked up that word, continual. It means constant, continual, always, daily. And I also looked up the word feast. It means an intoxicating drink. Shaka, not my word, God's word. As if
at a banquet.
It actually means to guzzle. So let's get our little communion cup so we can drink this morning real quick. Ready? You guys got an imaginary communion cup? Or no. It says a constant feast. So let's get out of Route 44 cherry limeade, right? No. That's not enough. Let's get out of our barrel of wine, okay? And we're going to take a drink this morning. You guys with? We're doing this by faith. You guys are participating in the life of God, right? We're going to take a big drink. You ready? Oh, thank you, Jesus. I have a good pop, all right? I feel better already.
Me too.
I don't even have to preach. We'll just go home. So, I'm going to read through a couple scriptures, and then I'm going to get into this. I'm going to try to stay with my notes because I got a lot of good stuff in here. But man, I've been studying this for 2 weeks and just hit this hardcore. And so I might just get off my notes and just preach it. And you might leave here going, "I don't understand anything he said." But next week I'll try to come back and make more sense. And then next week, and the more offering I give, I'll keep getting better and better. All right? Okay? You guys good with that? Proverbs 27:19. "As in the water reflects faith, so a man's heart reveals the man." I believe this is why when David comes along, God says, "I don't judge a man by the outward appearance. I look at his heart." Right? Because it reflects who he truly is. I actually believe this. I actually believe that when it says that David was a man after God's own heart, we used to think that he was trying to get God to love him or chase after it. I actually believe the heart is the root of your belief system. And David was a man that says, "I want to know who you are. Like, I don't care what they say about you. I don't care what anybody else thinks about you. I'm going to chase you down. I want to know what your heart is. I want to know your personality. I want to know what makes you tick. I want to know what makes you happy. I want to know what makes you sad. I want to know who you are." And David's the guy that his God's son, it says that Jesus is the son of David. Right? What an awesome honor to have. Shock out. Proverbs 4:23. You've heard me say this a couple times in here. "Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issue of life." I look up the word "issues" there. That word means boundaries. Guard your heart with all diligence, because out of it springs the boundaries of life. So the boundaries that have held you back for years, it's not your ex-girlfriend. It's not your wife. It's not your job. It's not your boss. The thing that's held you back from full stepping in the fullness is the what's in your heart. Your heart's kept you back. Because you might have a belief system here that agrees with the Word of God, but your heart has an opposing belief system. We're going to talk, I'm getting ahead of myself. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about rewriting our hearts today. That's the name of my message. Rewriting what's on our hearts. Jeremiah 29:13, he says, "You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart." See, we don't have conversations with God in our mind. We're not going to chase God's heart down by here. It's when we seek him with our heart. Right? This is how we begin to find God. This is why I put, can you bring those up? My heart. My heart sets boundaries. Right? I don't want more boundaries in my life. I want the fullness. I want the $1 million. I want the $1 billion. I want the fullness of what God has for me. I want peace. I want joy. I don't want to wake up hurting in the morning anymore. I want to wake up fully alive, full of energy, refreshed all the time. And those boundaries have got to come down because God says they can't come down, right? It reveals the core of who you are. Sometimes you might blow up in anger and you say, you know, it's not really funny, but you know, they used to do a joke where it's like a guy would hit his wife and go, "Look what you made me do," right? But the reality of it is even though that's not funny, but the reality of it is we always think that, right? That guy made me mad. This person did that. They offended me, right? It's the core of what's in you already. Nobody can make you mad, right? Nobody can, you know, we say this a lot here, nobody can offend you, right? You can only, if you have offense in your heart, when pressure gets applied, it's going to reveal what's in your heart. Amen? And it determines how you communicate with God. That's what those scriptures I just laid out for you say. It sets boundaries, it reveals who you are, and it determines your communication with God. Let me explain this to you real quick before I go ahead, because I'll get ahead and I'll forget it's back here. Since I started studying, I started doing good old-fashioned, just reading my Bible, studying. I reached out to Christy Metropolis, because she's somebody that's been here and taught a couple times. I reached out to Arthur Manges, because he taught it in the Restoration Conference. And I got a lot of resources from Dr. Jim Richards. And I saw a lot of diagrams of spirit, soul, body, and different people had different ones. I'm not saying that they're wrong. I'm just saying that this one, to me, seemed the most accurate, okay? Because here's the deal. If you understand spirit, soul, and body, my spirit is perfect right now. My spirit is holy. My spirit is righteous. My spirit is healed right now. And my soul is my thoughts, my emotions, my feelings, right? And my body is this, just my flesh, okay? Now, religion likes to teach us that this thing is bad, right? Like this thing's sinful. And because this thing's sinful, you always want to sin. But your spirit's always saying don't do it. And this is saying do it. And this is saying don't do it. That's garbage, okay? Jesus came in the flesh. He was 100% man. So if he had sinful flesh, then he couldn't have been the perfect sacrifice. You don't have sinful flesh. Well, why do I always battle with it? Because you don't believe the truth, right? Stop believing that you're a sinner and you will stop being a sinner. Okay? So, if we can see the heart as this, the heart is the seat of what I believe. Can you see that? Like, my belief system isn't what's up here, it's what's in here. Okay? My spirit is the true reality of who I am. This is how God sees me, this is how God communicates. This is my spirit cries out to God's spirit. My soul is my emotions, and my body is this outside thing. That I have my smell, my touch, my hearing, my taste, and my sight. Well, here's where we mess up a lot of times. We let what we smell, touch, hear, taste, and see, our body, tell our brain to tell our brain what reality is. And because of that, our emotions have feelings that come out of that rest in our heart. Does that make sense? So the circumstances might be that I feel sick, right? And I agree with what this feels like. And it begins to tell my soul. Well, my soul's the root of my emotions and my feelings. And so my emotions is as I'm sick, I'm sick, I'm sick. And what that does is it sends a message to my heart that says, you're sick. And I believe in my heart that I'm sick. So what we're going to try to do in here is we're going to try to reverse this thought process. Because this is how we should be led. My spirit is true, is holy, and righteous, the real me. We're going to let what the truth is dictate to my heart what the truth is. And in that, that's going to dictate to what my emotions, my feelings, and everything else is. It's going to tell my brain, it's going to manifest in my body. Does that make sense? Okay. Here's the last scripture. Let not mercy and kindness and truth leave you. This is Proverbs 3, verses 3 through 6. Let not mercy and kindness and truth leave you. Instead, let these qualities define you. Bind them securely around your neck and write them on the tablets of your heart. So I want to give you an illustration of what writing on the tablet of my heart looks like. How many in here remember back in the day when we would have vinyl records? Right? And they would, and so what they would do is they'd take a vinyl and they would actually cut grooves into the records until it made the sound that they wanted to make. And then we would buy, we'd go to Walmart and buy a needle. Right? I remember my first vinyl record, and it was the Beach Boys. I wish they all could be California. And I remember going to Walmart and buying the needle. My dad, I got it for Christmas. My dad took me down to Walmart. And so the needle, what happens is they take this record and they begin to cut grooves in it. And as they cut grooves in it, as it goes across, the needle picks up the different sounds it put out and it puts a sound out. Okay? So what we're going to talk about today is how we're going to cut new grooves in our heart so that our heart harmonizes with our mind, our soul, and our body. And then, I'm going to get off my notes. I'm just going to let this go, okay? Because I'm going to try to follow these and then probably better just explain them. So, what I want is I want the, what, since I'm going to get off my notes, let me rethink this for a second. What I want is I want this thing to be the thing that dictates everything. So I might have a belief system, like every year at New Year's, we do the resolution, right? Like, this year I'm going to quit smoking, this year I'm going to lose 1,000 pounds, this year I'm going to make $1 million, right? And for the first month, we might be doing really well, right? The first month, we might lose 10 pounds, and we're like, yeah, right? And as long as the motivation is there, we will continue to lose weight. But the reality of it is when my self-will or when my motivation begins to fall away, what is written in my heart will actually, by default, become back to my reality. So, you might say, for this day forward, I'm taking authority over this situation, and you press in and do you do all those things, but the second that you start getting tired, you start getting complacent, what's in your heart is going to be your reality. It's always going to default back to that. So if you feel like I have no shame and I have no condemnation, but in your mind you're saying, or in your heart you have shame and condemnation, but in your mind you think, I'm perfectly holy, I'm perfectly righteous. And then the first time a circumstance arises and you begin to, what happens is your heart really actually begins to manifest up before you. You know, the Bible actually says that in Song of Solomon, it says that when we sleep, our heart is awake. So when your heart is awake and your belief system is continually going over and over and over, even while you're not awake. So we're going to change that, right? Shaka, we want our heart. So what happens is, if I can actually persuade my heart or convince my heart to believe what is true, then it doesn't mean, so let's say it like this. Like, a bill, you ever had that bill show up that you weren't expecting? Or maybe you were expecting it, but it was supposed to be $500 and it came in at $5,000. You guys ever been to the doctor, emergency room? And he's like, that can't be that bad. It's like $900. And it shows up, it's like $7,000 or $8,000. And you're like, what the? Right? So the reality of it is even if your heart has been rewritten into truth, and you believe that God is my provider and God is my source, when I open that up, I might instantly go, whoa, that's too much. I can't do this. But what will happen is by default, my heart will actually take back over and say, no, God is your provider. God is your source. Stay at rest. But most of us, that's not what we do. Most of us, when that bill shows up, we begin to think about, we actually live out as if we didn't pay the bill. I'm talking about in 5 minutes from the time we open it. We didn't pay the bill, and it's already been sent to collection agency, and they're already taking my house and my boat and my car just in the 5 minutes because we've lived in our mind, we've lived out everything, right? Amen? We've actually imagined and we've lived out and we have meditated on what would happen if this didn't happen. And the reality was, the truth wasn't written in my heart that says, no, God is your provider. God is your source. He's going to take care of this. Sometimes we have to come to church and have somebody tell us that. But the reality of it is, where we're in church, we might say, yes, God is my provider. God is my source. I remember. And the second I go back out in the car and I stop thinking about it, I kick on the radio and I hope it's Christian music. But a lot of you guys, I know it's like 93.3 or something. And it begins to flow again. And the reality of it is as it as that music begins to flow, you forget that God is my provider, God is my source, and then all of a sudden my heart begins to say, you're not going to pay that bill. And I let fear, this is where, you know where depression, the root of depression is? It's anxiety, it's fear. It starts with fear, anxiety, depression. And again, it's a cycle that continues to flow over and over and over. Okay, I'm going to go through this real quick, make sure I'm not missing anything. Okay, this is, let's go to Romans, keep reading Romans 10. Verses 9 through 10. It says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that He has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. So three things. For with the heart one believes into righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made into salvation. So three things happen here. We bring up the belief. So Scott taught on this Wednesday if you were here. But we've always been told we need more faith. You got to work up more faith. You need more faith. You don't need any more faith. The Bible says that you have been given a measure. Every man's been given a measure of faith. And the Bible said, and Jesus said that if you have faith of a mustard seed, you can speak to this mountain. Is this thing cutting out? Is it just me? Yeah. Is it bad? Is it okay? Okay. The battery's going to be going down on me because I'm using a lot. So what Scott was teaching on Wednesday was you don't need any more faith. You have the gift of faith. You just got to believe it. I got enough faith in me. I'm walking around. I'm a faithful man. I walk around with faith. I'm packing faith, right? So believing is what? It's choosing. It's choosing to believe the truth about yourself. And so you don't have to work up more faith. You just need to believe, right? So to be saved, he says that you have to choose. You have to believe in the name of Jesus. He says you confess with your mouth. So what is true? I confess. So when the bill shows up and my mind goes, boom, you can't pay that, I say, my God is my provider. God is my source. I choose to believe it, and I begin to speak it out. And it says that experience, and this is where most of us miss it. To understand this, you have to understand, let's just use the word salvation there. Where you go back to my scripture, Romans 10:10. It says, confession is made unto salvation. So we've always thought, that means that I got my golden ticket and I'm going to heaven. Right? But confession, salvation is, it is, you are going to heaven. Okay? I believe we're going to heaven. That's great. But the reality of it is we're supposed to have life and life more abundantly here. Salvation isn't just about going to heaven. Salvation, the word actually means to deliver, to protect, to heal, preserve, to be made whole, to be made well. So when I believe in my heart that Jesus is the Lord, I speak it out, I actually experience what that means. You guys, how many of you remember when you were first saved? Remember your first salvation experience? You remember that? Or maybe it wasn't when you confessed. Maybe you had an encounter with Jesus. Do you remember, like, walking around on cloud nine everywhere you went? Like, before you were saved, you didn't even want to hear the name Jesus, and then you get saved, and you're, like, at McDonald's, and you're, like, just talking out loud so everybody can hear you. Jesus, Jesus. You start preaching, right? Just so everybody getting their Big Mac knows that you know Jesus, right? Because something inside of you has happened. Well, here's what I want to say to you today, and I'm going to skip about 1,000 notes, but I think it's okay because I think this is what the Holy Spirit wants me to do. Here's what I want to say to you today. It's not just that I believe, and it's not just that I confess, because we've all done that, right? How many of you have had something come up and we say, and we in our mind begin to say, no, that's not right, and I begin to confess truth. Like, I know Laura did it a year ago. She was doing it every day on Facebook. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And it didn't prosper. But at times, we've confessed that over our lives, and it did prosper, right? The battle did happen, and we did go through a fight, right? Because the reality of it was, is that the belief in my heart didn't line up with the belief in my mind or what I was confessing. And because of that, even though I was confessing it, and even though I was making myself believe it, trying to make myself believe it, I would always go back to doubt. I'd always not be fully convinced in my heart that it was true. And because of that, what was inside of me manifested outside of me. Are you with me? So, I'm going to give you a couple examples. I'm all over the place on my notes now, so I'll give you a couple examples. I'm going to say this real quick so I can make this point. Is what is in you is always what's going to come out of you. Okay? You can't say peace to a storm if you don't have peace in you. You can't give what you don't have. I can't give you $1 million if I don't have $1 million. I can't spiritually release peace over you if the inside of me is full of anxiety and fear. I can't give you rest if I haven't entered rest. I just can't do it. Jesus says in the parable of the sower, he talked about seed, which is the word being sown. And he says in one place, he says that seed lands in some soil and the fowl come and pluck it out of your heart. Right? So what's he saying? So the seed's not just to be landing on your mind. The seed is supposed to land in your heart and be embedded in your heart and grow, right? But then at the end of it, he says, those that the seed that falls on good soil will produce a harvest of 30, of 60, some 100-fold. So the seed that falls in you, that is embedded in your heart, will manifest the fruit out of you. Right? So for example, if I really believe in my heart that I'm prosperous, it's impossible for me not to become prosperous. If I really believe in my heart that I'm healed, this is something I read secularly. Hold this thought. I read this secularly. That what you think here actually goes to your heart, and what you're putting into your heart, every time your heart beats, it tells your cells what to believe. So if you're thinking, I'm sick, that thought goes into my heart, and then that tells my cells what to believe. But if I'm actually thinking that I'm healed, it goes into my heart. Actually, I read that this was a secular study. It said that every 7 years, your body gets new cells. So the cells that you had 7 years ago are completely new cells right now. So let's say that you had a cell that was cancerous. Right? And I believed in my heart that I am healed, that my body will actually kick out that cancerous cell. It'll bring it. And so some people say, well, that's kind of like New Agey stuff. I'm going to get a lot more New Agey than this in a minute. But here's the reality of it is, no, it's not. It's the truth. I am healed. And I am persuading and convincing my mind, my soul, and my body to believe. And if my body doesn't believe it, it might produce things in me that actually cause me to be sick. So I have to persuade my heart, my soul, and my body that I am healed. And it'll begin to kick out things that doesn't line up with what the truth is.
Amen.
Amen. So the Bible says, as a man thinketh, so is he. And that word thinketh, you look it up, it means gatekeeper. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So what's that saying? It's saying your thoughts are the gatekeeper to your heart. What's a gatekeeper? It's what comes in and what goes out. So your thoughts actually tell your heart what to believe, and then your belief, then your heart tells your mind what to believe. Right? I'm going to go to another scripture here. Make sure I don't skip anything. We're going to talk about how to rewrite our heart. Okay? Are you fully convinced that our problem is our heart doesn't line up? So I got a bunch of notes I could throw at you, but the purpose of all those notes was to fully convince you. The reason you're not seeing the fullness of God in your life is because you don't fully believe in your heart. I believe, and we have a lot of people talk about, we want to see signs, wonders, and miracles. We see a lot of guys, I want to see signs, wonders, and miracles everywhere. I don't want to just see it part-time. I want to see it every time they lay hands on somebody. I want to see sick people come out of wheelchairs. I want to see people that are battling with cancer be healed. I want cancer to die right now in Jesus' name. I believe, and so it says that when we seek God with all of our heart, we'll find Him. So I believe the reason a lot of times we don't see these things is because we haven't really seeked God with all of our heart. We haven't begun to believe in our heart that there is a spiritual realm and there's a physical realm. And I actually am supposed to be living from the spiritual realm. And as I live from the spiritual realm, that everything in the natural has to bow down to that spiritual realm. You know, in the Bible, it talks about Adam. His job was to tend the garden of pleasure. Like you might read in your Bible, Eden, but the word means pleasure. And it says that there's a river that brought gold to him. See, when we begin to go back to what we call garden works of Adam, the earth is going to spit her riches at you because of who you are. When you're fully persuaded in your mind, this is who I am, you're going to see the earth begin to spit her gold and spit her riches at you. Amen? Okay, let's go here. Isaiah 26:3. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. This is something that Arthur taught on at the conference, and it didn't hit me that night what he was trying to say. I don't know if he was trying to say this, it just how it came to me. He said, that word mind, you have that up? Yeah, he'll keep him in perfect peace, whose mind. That word is imaginations. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose imaginations is stayed up on you, because he trusts in you. So belief is this. Belief is choosing to believe. Belief is speaking, and belief is experiencing. So, it's possible. Actually, I have this in my notes. Let me see if I can find it real quick so I say it right. If I can't, I'll just say it. I can't find it. So, I'll just say it like this. It's possible that I choose and I speak something that I don't experience. Right? Like, I might be sick, and I'm choosing to speak, and I'm choosing to believe that I'm healed, and I'm choosing to speak that I'm healed, but my body is not feeling healed. So what do? We have to close our eyes and begin to imagine what it would be like to be healed. And you'll begin to feel feelings of what it's like to be healed. And you're going to begin to meditate on those feelings. And you're going to begin to persuade your heart to believe that you're healed. Now that might sound New Agey, because it is New Agey. But here's the deal. Jesus said this. He said, if you look at a woman and lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. What's he saying? He's saying that if you look at a woman and lust, you have already thought every thought, and you've already imagined what it would be like, whatever your thoughts are, and because of that, you have already, in your heart, committed adultery with her, even though you never touched her. Your body has already released the chemicals that comes involved. Your body releases chemicals, right? The young people releases chemicals, right? And what he's saying is that you've, in your heart, you've lived this thing out. And in your heart, this is a reality. You've already committed adultery with that woman. And you say, Pastor, I don't believe that we should imagine things. Okay. But you do it all the time. You live in, you imagine things all the time. How many times, what if somebody's done something wrong to you, and you're thinking, when I see that son of a gun, I'm going to say this, I'm going to say that. If they say this to me, we're going to throw down, right? And 9 times out of 10, nothing ever happens, right? But in your heart, you've already imagined it. You've already lived it out. You've already thought what you're going to say and what you're going to do. And in your heart, that has become your reality. So what if, instead of us with all the negative things that we put into our heart, what if we were intentional about closing my eyes and saying and thinking about and imagining what it feels like to be joyful? Maybe some things that cause you to be joyful. Maybe like your puppy makes you be joyful. Right? I just had a thought of Angela's puppy and that anger raised up in me. Maybe your wife brings joy to you. Maybe fishing brings joy to you. And as you begin to close your eyes and imagine that feeling of joy, you begin to meditate on it. You begin to ponder it. Say something. I got my notes all screwed up. I don't do well with notes. I don't know why I keep doing it. But I actually meditate on the feeling or the emotion until that feeling or that emotion becomes my feeling and then my emotion. And I do it to the point that I no longer, what used to be on my heart is no longer there anymore. See, most of the things that are written on our heart is from things that people have done to us, things we've done to ourselves, and it becomes our belief system. And we're always in the same cycle, a never-ending cycle. Right? If you ever notice, if there's any women here that's been in domestic violence, I'm not coming against you at all. But you see women that have been in domestic violence leave one domestic violence person and go to another domestic violence person and go to another domestic violence person. And if you really study back, what you're probably going to find out is they grew up in a domestic situation. And so what was written in their hearts as young people became their normal. And as it became their normal, they were always attracted because the belief system in their heart was, this is normal, this is normal, and this is normal. And people that didn't grow up in that, we see that and go, that's crazy. Why are you going back to that? But you can't convince them because what's in their heart is that this is a normal life. Right? If you, you know, this, everything in our life always goes back. We etched into our life what was written on our heart. So what I'm saying to you is that it might be weird, but purposely begin to imagine what would it be like if I was rich? And see those, begin to experience those feelings of being real. What would it be like if I was healed? What would it be like if I was at peace all the time? And then I close my eyes, I begin to imagine peace. And then in that, I begin to ponder and meditate on peace until that emotion becomes my reality. And then I convince my heart or persuade my heart that that is my normal reality to the point that the next time a circumstance arises, not saying that I won't have a brief second of going back, but my heart, I'll always revert back to what my heart believes, and my heart's going to say, no, peace is your underlying belief system. And what if I changed the course of my life from this day forward because I actually put some of these things into practice? You know, one of the things that I struggled with in ministry was I was always insecure because I didn't come from a pastor. My dad wasn't a pastor. I didn't grow up in ministry. I don't have any doctorates or didn't go to Bible school, any of those things. And I've really been blessed with some friends that got their whole office wall is certified, certified, certified. And I go visit with them or whatever, and I sometimes think, man, I'm not qualified for this, right? So I have to take time, and I have to close my eyes, and I have to say, no, I am qualified because He qualified me. And I began to experience the emotion of what it feels like to be qualified, what it feels like to be secure, and then I meditate on that until I actually fully receive that. I'll give you one more example. We've done this in this church before. Peter Sports, the first person that did it. He came in here one Sunday, or Wednesday, sometime, he came in here and he says, I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to imagine that you're on a beach. I'm sure where I was at, because I always go to the beach. But, or your favorite place, and the birds are chirping, and everything's fine. And off in the distance, you see somebody walking to you. And as they get closer, you realize that somebody's Jesus. You know how many people in here had encounters with God from that? You know, I actually did that in Maryland, and how many prophetic words came out of that. That after that imagination, you take it from there and you have a conversation with Jesus. Because in my heart, because then that's when I begin to experience God in my heart, right? In my imagination. So here's what I want to do today. Can we stand up? First thing we have to do is we have to say to ourselves, Lord, I've got a hard heart. Circumstances in my life, I always have an endless cycle. And Lord, I know it's not my wife. I know it's not my job. I know it's not this. I know it's not that. I know because my heart's not completely persuaded of your goodness. Completely persuaded of your love for me. And Lord, I don't want a hard heart anymore, Lord. I want to walk in the fullness of what you have. You paid a price to give me a right to the entire kingdom. That I acknowledge, that I choose to believe what God says. And we can teach and instruct on different ways to persuade our heart. But at the end of the day, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit is our teacher. He's the one that instructs us. He's the one that guides us. And so, then the next thing I say to the Lord is I don't want a hard heart, and I need you to help lead me. And I need you to help guide me. I will be intentional with my thoughts. I'll be intentional with my time of meditation. I'll be intentional in believing the truth until I begin to experience the truth, Lord. But I need you to help guide me and lead me into these things. You realize that sometimes God will bring up things in our life that we've been holding on to for a long time, and then we'll actually deal with that. And then like 6 months later, He brings up something else. He's never going to bring up things in our heart that we're not ready to deal with. But we say, Lord, I need your Holy Spirit to help guide me and lead me through this process. But today, before we leave, what I want you to do is I want you to imagine in your mind, so it translates to your heart, what does it feel like to be unconditionally loved? And you might, some of us might have a hard time because maybe we've never experienced unconditional love. But if you're a parent, I want you to think about the love for your child. Let that emotion begin to flow. If you have a revelation of God's unconditional love for you, I want you to meditate on unconditional love. And as those feelings begin to come up, because you'll have feelings, right? Your thoughts produce feelings. And your feelings produce thoughts. I want you to think until you begin to produce the feelings of unconditional love. I'm just being loved, being embraced right now. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. Lord, I release your Holy Spirit to guide us and lead us into experiences of unconditional love. One thing I didn't say a while ago is believing is not just a mental assent. Believing is also experiencing. The Bible says to know the love of God. The word to know is to experience the love of God. When Jesus says in the parable of the sower, he says, those who receive the seed and do not understand it, that word understand, if you break it down to the root word, it is to unite with or to experience it. So we have to experience the truth in our minds and then in our thoughts, and then we feel them, and then we persuade our heart that this is the truth. I feel love. I feel healed. I feel made whole. I feel saved. I feel the fullness flowing in me and out of me. Hallelujah, Father. So let's just take a minute. Experience that emotion, that feeling. Meditate on it until you begin to change the feeling or the emotion that maybe you're experiencing that contradicts that. Discouragement has got to go. Condemnation has to go. Shame has to go. It's not part of the package. It's reigned and ruled my life for too long. Now your unconditional love is going to be the seat of my heart. And everything from this point forward is going to flow out of that feeling, out of that emotion. That I'm unconditionally loved and I'm unconditionally accepted. That you are for me and you're never against me. You have given your son freely. You cannot hold anything back from me. You've given everything to me. I want to encourage you as you go forward after today. When you drive to work in the morning, when you got that time of silence with just you, that you begin to imagine the things of God. Stop questioning. Why am I not seeing this? Why is this not happening? And begin to imagine that it is happening. See, God's faith is this. I believe Jesus said in Mark 11, have God's kind of faith. What is God's kind of faith? God sees the end. So what I'm telling you is we know the truth. The end has already been revealed to us. We win. So whatever circumstance it is, you can imagine the end as victorious and experience those feelings and those emotions. Meditate on those until your heart's fully persuaded. I'm blessed. I'm favored. I am loved. I am healed. I'm a child of God. I'm no longer a slave. To the point that that becomes the root of my heart and my foundation of my belief system. That no matter what pops up, that my heart takes over and it begins to reveal truth to me. My emotions and my thoughts and my feelings always align up with what my heart believes. Hallelujah, Father. If you're standing beside somebody, if you just take your hand and just hold their hand or put your hand on their shoulder or something, we're going to worship here for just a second. I want you to minister over them, release the Holy Spirit upon them. That when you leave today, that you're encouraged, that you're edified. I want you to make a personal commitment that I will take time to imagine my life as I want it to be. I will see my life as the Word of God says it is. You make that commitment to yourself that you will no longer accept anything less than God's reality. It is yours because Christ is in you. Maybe some of you have arthritis in your body right now. I want you to imagine what it was like before arthritis, and I want you to begin to write that on your heart. We're going to cut new grooves in that heart so it makes the sound. It harmonizes with our spirit and our soul and our body, and everything comes into one alignment. That we walk out of here today healed, blessed, favored. We're not trying to get anything from God. We're just receiving what He has already given us, what's already been deposited in my spirit. I'm not going to allow a heart system, opposing belief system, to keep from what's in my spirit to manifest in my soul and to manifest in my physical reality.